Okay, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. So the topic is basically psychological or psychiatric disturbances associated with endocrine disorders, but they were more related to the neuropsychiatric phenomena. So I had modified the topic as neuropsychiatric manifestations of endocrine disorders. It has long been known that endocrine disorders are associated with neuropsychiatric symptoms. In 1786, Perry described psychotic symptoms associated with hyperthyroidism, and Graves first lectured on the psychiatric complications of hyperthyroidism in 1834. So centuries back, it has been known that these endocrine disorders, they have so close association with psychiatric manifestation as their first presentation. Psychiatric symptoms can precede or present concurrently with the more typical physical symptoms of endocrine disease. So it will be very tricky for you to identify if the psychiatric patient has underlying disorder or not, because these symptoms can actually precede. The psychiatric manifestations of these secondary endocrine disorders can be impossible to distinguish from primary psychiatric disorders, like the true depression, mania, psychosis, anxiety, delirium, or dementia. So, the psychiatric manifestations are so vast. There can be simple anxiety, depression, but there can be severe forms of psychotic disorders like dementia and delirium. And the endocrine disorders would then be considered as secondary psychiatric disorders if they are presenting with psychiatric manifestations. When psychiatric symptoms are thought to be secondary to endocrine disease, the primary treatment focus remains correcting the underlying endocrine disorder. Otherwise, you will not be able to control the psychiatric symptoms of such patients. Obviously, you have to address the hormonal disbalance. That being said, there are times when the psychiatric symptoms are severe enough to warrant immediate intervention, like mania, psychosis, and severe depression that could be life-threatening. Although you may be working upon the underlying endocrine disorder, that what is the actual diagnosis, for example, if patient has hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism, but at the time when the patient is presenting with severe mania, he or she is, screaming out actually causing harm to him or herself or others, you may have to intervene and give, psychiatric treatment as a first step. So let's begin with the individual endocrine disorders which have psychiatric associations. Obviously, thyroid disorders and hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis comes up immediately in the mind. There are numerous psychiatric symptoms which can be associated with hyperthyroidism, and this includes psychosis, depression, mania, anxiety, and cognitive dysfunction. These can occur with either primary hyperthyroidism like Graves' disease, toxic nodular goiter, or excessive consumption of exogenous thyroid hormone, that is factitious thyrotoxicosis. So if patient can present with, excessive thyroxine intake and can present that he or she is actually maniac and, may want to, achieve some goals, some psychiatric goals or personal goals through that, then it becomes very tricky if patient has factitious thyrotoxicosis or true hyperthyroidism. Brownlee and colleagues reported a series of 18 patients, of which mania was present in 7 patients, depression in 7 patients, psychosis in 3, and delirium in 1 patient. Thus, the range of neuropsychiatric symptoms seen with hyperthyroidism is quite broad. The presenting neuropsychiatric symptoms of hyperthyroidism include emotional lability, a poor impulse control, crying spells, euphoria, irritability, distractibility, reduced attention, impaired recall, and psychosis. Psychosis can include delusions and hallucinations. The difference between them, delusions are the false and firm belief that a patient believes that there is someone who is after him or someone who is making conspiracies against him, and you cannot, convince the patient that this is not so, this is not true. And the patient is unable to believe on that, and he continues to believe that no, there is someone who is, coming after him or her. And in hallucinations, patients start seeing objects or hearing things which is actually not happening. This is what is hallucinations. I remember in my residency, I had come across a case when I was rotating in psychiatry ward. There was a patient who was having this hallucination and delusion problem, that means the psychosis. And later on, we got to know that the patient was actually having Graves' disease. Severe hyperthyroidism was there. And once we started treating her, she got really under control. Otherwise, she was kept in a separate room because of her such, you know, high euphoria and grandiosity type of behaviors. A minority of patients can present with symptoms of depression, apathy, or lethargy in hyperthyroidism as well. But usually with hyperthyroidism, you expect higher, hyper features, positive type of, you know, psychiatric manifestations rather than negative. That is depression. Apathy. Apathy means there is no feeling, no expression of what's going on inside, what the person is thinking. That is called apathy. And sometimes you get confused with this apathy and you're unable to diagnose hyperthyroidism in such cases. That's why it is called apathetic hyperthyroidism. You may come across these terms in the books. That patient is actually depressed and apathic, but actually there is underlying hyperthyroidism going on. And this is important to know because that person can develop atrial fibrillation and heart failure, and actually can land up with thyroid storm. So these are very tricky patients. Usually they are elderly, old age patients. They have no feelings to express and somehow they have underlying background of depression or anxiety depression disorders. So moving on to hypothyroidism now, mixed edema, neuropsychiatric symptoms include cognitive dysfunction, affective disorders, and psychosis. So again, the broad spectrum of psychiatric manifestation with one end having negative symptoms of, you know, cognitive dysfunction and the other hand having affective disorder and psychosis with mania and all can happen in hypothyroidism as well. The onset of symptoms is often gradual and slow progression is common, especially in the elderly, mimicking the development of degenerative dementia. Because patient will have cognitive dysfunction, they will not be able to, you know, focus on their daily task. They may have memory problems, they may be confused, not able to think, not able to reply. Simple tasks like keeping clothes in place, forgetting about having a breakfast just a while ago, and so on. So, and in elderly, you often think that these are having Alzheimer's or dementia. And no one would think about thyroid. So this is again very tricky. And then common symptoms include slowed comprehension and impairment in attention, recent memory, and abstract thinking. So a lot of cognitive dysfunction is actually more associated with hypothyroidism. Difference from cortical dementia such as Alzheimer's disease and frontotemporal degeneration. What is the difference between the cognitive dysfunction of these disorders and hypothyroidism? So that the cognitive disorder of mixed edema does not present with discrete cortical syndromes like aphasia, anomia, apraxia, and frontal disinhibition. You know, the cortex is not really, anatomically and structurally involved in mixed edema. It's only the function. But in Alzheimer's and frontotemporal, which are actual cortical diseases where cortical degeneration, cortical cells, cortical tissue is affected, then the function of the cortex is also affected. Patient is aphasic. Aphasia means unable to recall the real memory, unable to comprehend, unable to think further, unable to name objects as anomia, apraxia, and so on. These are typical, you know, neuropsychiatric terms and are associated with cortical function exactly. And they're not present in hypothyroid patients. Coming to the affective disorder in case of hypothyroidism. So the most common affective disorder seen in hypothyroidism is depression, manifested most often as reduced mood, psychomotor retardation, sleep and appetite disturbances, anhedonia, means patient is not, you know, feeling any pain. Anhedonia is that. And reduced libido and emotional lability. So patient is very slow, unable, less expressive. Depressed. Depression is very common actually with hypothyroidism and mood disorder. Often, you know, I get couples coming with husband and wife, and the husband says about wife that she has a very bad mood. She does not take interest in the daily activities in the family. So this is a very important and common presentation. Then suicidal thinking, delusions, and hallucinations can be present in more advanced illnesses. However, they are very rare. And they are associated with the positive or, you know, psychotic symptoms of these affective disorders. Hypothyroidism had a greater risk of being admitted for the treatment of depression or bipolar disorder with greater risk in the first year. Obviously, you can imagine someone having depression would first be attended by the psychiatrist rather than endocrine. A meta-analysis of individuals with treatment-resistant depression, it showed that there was 50% cases who had subclinical hypothyroidism. And the response to antidepressant therapy is known to be reduced if the thyroid disease is not treated. So, you know, being endocrinologists, you get a lot of referral from psychiatrists as well, especially with slightly raised TSH and person is actually depressed. And they want you to assess if the patient can be started on thyroid replacement therapy. Treatment of the underlying hypothyroidism will treat the neuropsychiatric symptoms. So once you start them on thyroxine replacement, they feel very good and energetic and, you know, back to life. Although they are in the subclinical state, but still the subclinical is with respect to the severe hypothyroid manifestation. But depression is often ignored in such cases. So this is also a very important symptom of hypothyroidism. Thyroid replacement alone may not be effective in producing remission of the depressive symptoms in some cases. And sometimes you also have to give, you know, antidepressants or mood elevating drugs which have effect. Now coming to the psychosis. Compared to depression, mania is a much less common manifestation of hypothyroidism. However, there are a number of reported cases of hypothyroidism presenting with symptoms of mania. As I told you, that hyperthyroidism is more associated with mania or psychotic episodes, and depression is more in hypothyroidism. These are the concepts which we learn when we are undergraduates as well. But extremes of cases can happen in both conditions. So patient can actually present with mania as well. So patient can present with elevated mood and energy, irritability, psychomotor agitation, decreased need for sleep, sleep is gone, increased goal-directed behavior, pressured sleep, flight of ideas, grandiosity, hallucinations, and delusions. So again, I see a lot of female patients coming to my clinic, and they are very anxious, and there is a lot of anxiety, and they're actually shivering with, you know, that anxiety that I'm unable to, you know, concentrate at my home, and there are so many matters which are out of my hand. I'm unable to take care of my children, and they actually turn out to be hypothyroid rather than hyperthyroid. So hypothyroidism has been associated with psychosis in myxedema madness, which is called myxedema madness. You know, again, they are so famous and well-known terms, and there is no typical presentation of psychotic symptoms, which can include delusions, paranoia, auditory and visual hallucinations, perseveration, and thought disorganization. Perseveration is more like obsession. You keep on doing the same thing repeatedly until you're satisfied, and sometimes you're never satisfied. Psychosis has been noted in 5 to 15% of patients with hypothyroidism. So again, we do study in our books, and often in medical books, there are two different extremes of clinical presentations with respect to hyper and hypothyroidism is explained. But in clinical practice, anything can happen with either patient. A patient with hypothyroidism can actually present with features of hyper, which can include weight loss as well, and palpitation, anxiety, anything can really happen. And the opposite can go on with patient with hyperthyroidism. Now, moving on to the adrenal disorders. Okay, now coming to the adrenal disorders, hypercortisolemia, that is Cushing's syndrome. The cognitive dysfunction has been noted in approximately 2/3 of patients with Cushing's syndrome. The major impairments seen are nonverbal, visual ideational, visual memory, and spatial constructional abilities. So they are very difficult psychiatric terms, actually. And if you understand from this nonverbal, visual, ideational, so they are more related to hallucination, and I think these spatial constructional abilities, patients are not able to work much. They keep on sitting in one place and they are not moving around. They have no interest in their surrounding, actually, what is going on. Major depression was on average 57%, with a range of 50 to 80% across studies. So if there was this study in which there was in patients with Cushing's syndrome, and major depression was found to be on an average of 57%. Patients with depression appear to have a more severe clinical presentation and have higher cortisol levels than patients with increased cortisol without depression. So when a patient with Cushing's syndrome comes in your clinic, and you will recognize and you'll realize that patient is not taking much interest of his or her own condition. He or she is obese, pushing void with flushing of face, and so many, you know, actually the whole body image is gone, but they're not taking much interest as to what is going on, their least interest. And they are the patients who have a higher cortisol levels. They have true and, you know, exuberant kind of Cushing white features and Cushing white manifestation. Mania and Cushing syndrome presents less commonly than depression, though approximately 30% of patients present with hypomanic or manic symptoms, subclinical mood fluctuations being more common. So yes, mania is less common. Hypomania or mania may be some of the earliest signs of illness onset. Anxiety can be commonly associated with Cushing syndrome. The rate of generalized anxiety disorder has been noted to be as high as 79% and panic disorder as high as 53%. So if you see, after depression, anxiety would be the one to be present in patient with Cushing syndrome. And then you can say, okay, the mania, the extreme form of anxiety can be there. Now, how do you manage it? In thyroid, we learned that we have to treat the thyroid hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism, whereas in now Cushing. So successful control of hypercortisolism can result in a progressive improvement of psychiatric symptoms and cognitive function. In a Cushing syndrome cohort, there was this study from Pereira et al. Where 33 patients were studied, and the prevalence of diagnosed psychopathology even after cure of the Cushing was 54% at 3 months and 36% at 6 months and 24% at 1 year. Some patients with Cushing syndrome continue to have this psychiatric manifestation since up to 1 year, even after getting cured. And in this cohort, a 74-patient cohort continued to experience impairments in memory and executive function despite long-term cure of the Cushing's disease. When they kept on, you know, following their cases in their center, so they found out that even after the long-term cure, Cushing's, there is still, you know, not complete recovery. Thus, they required treatment with antidepressants, though the primary disease was taken care of well. Now, coming to adrenal insufficiency, that is Addison's disease, mostly there is mild disturbances in mood, motivation, and behavior were described as core clinical symptoms. Psychosis and extensive cognitive changes, including delirium, were less common and associated with more severe disease. Catatonia and self-mutilation were still more rarely seen in such cases. Catatonia, these are the extrapyramidal motor syndromes. They are the manifestation of certain movement disorders, actually. And self-mutilation is a behavior where patient produce harm to him or herself, self-mutilate. They may cut their fingers, they may cut their body parts and, you know, with the knife, or maybe suicidal, but not always. They just want to, you know, destroy their body. That is self-mutilation. So adrenal insufficiency is generally treated by replacing hydrocortisone. Thompson et al. Note that patients with adrenal insufficiency may be at risk for developing severe affective disorders, and in particular may be at risk for developing elevated mood symptoms in the context of receiving hormone replacements. So obviously, when the patient is severely cortisol deficient and you start replacing them with cortisol, suddenly they can develop different moods manifestation. There can be elevated mood, and during therapy, you have to be careful that if you are giving overdose of hydrocortisone or steroid, you have to be careful with the mood elevation and manifestations. So you have to counsel them ahead that such anxiety elevation may come up. So be cautious with that. Now coming to the functional secretory pituitary tumors. Number one is the prolactinoma, because prolactinoma is the most common type of pituitary tumor, which is a secretory adenoma. Hyperprolactinemia can manifest like galactorrhea, gynecomastia, amenorrhea, decreased libido, and sexual dysfunction. Drugs which are associated with hyperprolactinemia include antipsychotics, antidepressants, and dopamine receptor antagonists. So the point, the basic purpose of, you know, reviewing these points is that it is often the treatment of psychiatric disorders that you get this endocrine disorder, this hyperprolactinemia, rather than, you know, having prolactinoma being associated with psychiatric problem, it is the other way around. Because there are conditions, there are psychiatric conditions, psychiatric diseases, when you treat them with these antidepressants like amitriptyline and, you know, this risperidone, for example, they lead to prolactin, high prolactin levels and hyperprolactinemia leading to these problems. So how do you manage such cases? It is more of a, you know, management challenge rather than, you know, the diagnosis and so on. So a careful balance between decreasing the prolactin and maintenance of the adequate control of the underlying psychiatric disorder is important. You don't want to have high prolactin level because that is causing amenorrhea, galactorrhea type of thing in females especially. And you don't want to, you know, put off the patient from psychiatric drug. Otherwise, the patient will go into the psychiatric emergencies. So you need to keep a good balance in that. Switch to an alternative antipsychotic such as quetiapine or olanzapine, which is less likely to exacerbate hyperprolactinemia. So drugs which have less effect of causing hyperprolactinemia should be on choice, especially in such patients. Aripiprazole might actually decrease prolactin and due to its mixed dopaminergic antagonism and agonism. So it is often seen that now aripiprazole is being, you know, preferred in such cases where you suspect. In fact, now it is becoming psychiatric medication of choice in such cases and generally to avoid these hormonal disbalances. The use of a dopamine agonist such as bromocriptine or cabergoline may theoretically, though rarely, lead to worsened psychotic symptoms despite the patients remaining on an antipsychotic. So you see, dopamine agonists, that is bromocriptine and cabergoline, are given for managing hyperprolactinemia because you want to lower down the prolactin level to get rid of those galactorrhea, amenorrhea symptoms, especially in females. So just be careful that you are starting them on these dopamine agonists. They may worsen the psychotic symptoms. So get in touch with the psychiatrist or the patient and explain them what you are aiming and what they have to then take care of. Next is acromegaly. This is also pituitary adenoma, which secretes growth hormone. So a clinical syndrome that results from sustained hypersecretion of growth hormone from pituitary adenoma. Neuropsychiatric manifestations include depression, pathological gambling, psychosis, amotivational syndrome, harm avoidance, neurosis, anticipatory worry, pessimism, and reduced impulsivity and less novelty-seeking behaviors. So again, if you look into these terms, they are more on the negative side. Patient want to stay quiet on his own, don't want to socialize. And if so, they will think about negative aspects in the society. That's the pathological gambling and pessimism. They don't have good hopes. They are depressed. And increased lifetime rates of affective disorders, especially major depression and dysthymia, can actually happen, which persisted even after curative surgery. So these patients remain depressed even after they are cured. So acromegaly is associated with more negative symptoms. Octreotide for the treatment of acromegaly has very few psychiatric side effects. Depressive symptoms are seen in 1 to 4% of patients in one of the studies. And anxiety, decreased libido, paranoia, or amnesia is seen in less than 1% of patients in such cases. So again, in endocrine manifestation, in psychiatric manifestations of endocrine disorders, the endocrine disorder itself and their treatments are you know, quite challenging to you know, with respect to the psychiatric side effects. You have to be very careful, especially with prolactinoma and acromegaly, as we have come across now. Hyperpituitarism, as we have discussed, the hypersecretory effects like Cushing, acromegaly, and prolactinoma. Now, hyperpituitarism, the infundibular hypothalamic anatomy is relatively fragile, especially in cases like traumatic brain injury, subarachnoid hemorrhage, or brain tumors. And brain tumors is a very vast term. It can include pituitary tumors, cellar tumors, and non-cellar tumors as well, like other brain tumors, the glial tumors, and so on. In any case, the hypothalamic anatomy, the infundibular stalk, and then pituitary gland itself, they become very much affected. So there is it increases the patient's risk of developing hypopituitarism anyway, with the first and most common sign of pituitary impairment being growth hormone deficiency. Neuropsychiatric manifestations of hyperpituitarism, especially growth hormone deficiency, would be amotivation, dysphoria, disturbed sleep pattern, personality change, affective blunting. Again, patient is unable to express his or her emotions. Auditory visual hallucinations, cognitive impairment, including visual and verbal memory impairment, decreased quality of life. So you see, when you are dealing with hypopituitarism, you often treat them first of all for steroid, any steroid cortisol deficiency, because they are life-saving treatments, and you have to address those hormonal deficiencies first, which are associated with life-threatening manifestations. So you check the cortisol excess and treat that or replace that, and then thyroxine, the thyroid excess, then replace that. Then maybe, you know, their gonadotropin excess becomes important, because there is amenorrhea or decreased libido in males and amenorrhea in females. You have to address that because they are associated with their daily, day-to-day life. Growth hormone excess is often, you know, ignored, and it often comes to be addressed in the last, because it is often said that you have to replace the cortisol excess, the thyroid excess first, and make sure they are adequately replaced. Then you have to assess whether the patient should have growth hormone replacement or not. Unfortunately, the growth hormone replacements are very costly, and they have no long-term trials and data to, you know, report their outcome benefits. That's why it is often ignored. And then when you step on to assess the adult growth hormone deficiency, you find these features of neuropsychiatric manifestations which come up on the list. And as you see, there is a decrease interest in the life, visual and verbal memory impairment, decreased quality of life. So the quality of life is often affected, and it is often, labeled to the fact that this patient is hypogonad or this patient is hypothyroid, that's why. But it is actually the growth hormone which has the role in such cases. So management is, regardless of the etiology, the use of psychotropic agents is directed at the nature of the presenting symptoms. Example, antidepressant is given for depression, and anxiolytics is given for anxiety, and antipsychotics for psychosis. These are suggested only after the correction of the underlying endocrine abnormality. Many neuropsychiatric symptoms significantly improve with hormone replacement. Now we'll start with the major topic, that is diabetes. Now, diabetes itself is, I think, the psychiatric manifestation of diabetes with all its spectrum of psychiatric illnesses is a whole big topic. I'll try to cover this, but let's see. It is generally acknowledged, and it has so much of its own, I mean, diabetes disease, then its treatment, management, complications, all these parameters, all these aspects are individually associated with psychiatric manifestations. So it is generally acknowledged that the presence of psychiatric illness in the context of diabetes can affect patient motivation and compliance with the treatment recommendations. This is the first and the foremost point. As such, psychiatric comorbidity is associated with decreased quality of life, increased cost of care, elevated hemoglobin A1C, and greater end organ damage. Obviously, if someone is depressed, don't want to take care of him or herself, the hyperglycemia and the complications are self-explanatory in such cases. Diabetes mellitus and depression. Depression is nearly twice as common in individuals with diabetes as in those without. Now you see, I've put on diabetes with an arrow towards depression, and you see this is a double-ended arrow. With more diabetes, there is more depression. And if there is more depression, this will lead to more diabetes, because a depressed person is so less motivated to take care of him or herself. A diabetes is getting worse day by day. Risk of this is that when pre-existing depression is non-severe, persistent, and untreated, then the patient develops diabetes, actually. The association involves both health-related behavior and physiological abnormalities in the hypothalamic, pituitary, adrenal, and sympathoadrenal systems that increase insulin resistance. So, you know, it is not only verbal and it is not only societal or social or you can say associated with day-to-day life. It is actually anatomical. It is actually structural and organic. There is a physiological abnormality in the axis, in the adrenal, in the endocrine axis, hypothalamic, pituitary, adrenal, and so on, where it is leading to insulin resistance, which has association with depression. Treatment of depression in diabetics is much the same as in non-diabetics. Antidepressants may affect appetite and blood glucose, and a patient may re-engage in physical activity, which may further influence glycemic control. So you see, when the patient is being treated for depression, the antidepressants can have their own metabolic derangements. There are some drugs which increase the appetite, and then patient can gain weight and blood glucose will rise. And then sometimes patient can become so active after antidepressant use, they can be engaged in physical exertion or exercises, can have actually, you know, hypoglycemia in such cases if they are put on high antidiabetic drug doses. The SSRIs, the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, are the preferred treatment for depression in diabetics due to their lack of effect on glucose metabolism, lower incidence of weight gain and carbohydrate craving, as well as the lower but not absent risk of anticholinergic and cardiac side effects. So that's why you may have come across in practice that SSRIs are now on the rise in use, and we often prescribe them. They can suppress appetite, enhance insulin sensitivity, and lead to hypoglycemia if diet and medication, oral hypoglycemic or insulin, are not adjusted accordingly. So make sure you are checking their sugar chart regularly. Tricyclic antidepressants should be avoided in the treatment of depression in patients with diabetes, as studies show a correlation with impaired fasting glucose as well as increased appetite and carbohydrate craving. So, you know, the tricyclic antidepressants are now becoming old-fashioned. Coming to the diabetes and anxiety, the prevalence of anxiety disorder, specifically generalized anxiety disorder, in diabetes is 2 to 3 times that in non-diabetics. As with depression, the presence of comorbid anxiety and diabetes mellitus is associated with elevated HbA1c levels. This is the same as we see in depression. Symptoms of anxiety disorders and depressive disorders often overlap, making very distinct differentiation quite difficult. Caution, however, should be used with pharmacotherapy, such as benzodiazepines and beta blockers, as they may mask the physiological symptoms of hypoglycemia, including tachycardia. So you see, for anxiety, we often give propranolol by the name of Enrol to control the anxiety symptoms if they are very mild and if you're not sure which anti-anxiety to start. So be careful. Even with benzodiazepines, we often prescribe. So if patient can have hypoglycemia, especially elderly or those who are not taking care of themselves or on insulin therapy, then make sure you advise them and counsel them about doing a regular sugar monitoring to keep a check on the change in their blood glucose profile so that you can adjust the drugs accordingly. Factors which are associated with more severe anxiety in diabetics. Now, these are the risk factors, and the other are the protective factors. The risk factor being female gender, presence of diabetes complications, patients who are using insulin, if they are unemployed, they are smokers, and there is a past or present misuse of alcohol. These factors make a patient prone to develop anxiety. Whereas patients who are older aged, structured medical care and private medical insurance available to them, and the patient perception of adequate glycemic control is there, then they are found to have less manifestations of anxiety being diabetic. So we have observed this. Obviously, financial cost and, you know, cost of care is always a matter of anxiety to anyone in any health setup, in any sector. And if that is adequately taken care of, then who would be, you know, prone to have such psychiatric manifestations? Now, coming to the diabetes, eating disorders, and eating disordered behavior. Many studies have shown that diabetics engaging in eating disordered behavior, particularly insulin omission or underuse, are at particularly elevated risk of experiencing physical complications of diabetes. Obviously, there's a fear of weight gain with insulin or having so many medications to take. It may affect their body, it may affect their weight. This thought is often, you know, interfering with their diabetes control. So treatment of eating disorders using a team approach, including physician, diabetes educators, nutritionists, and therapists is required. And here we need a multidisciplinary, you know, team and multidisciplinary department, actually, where all such specialists can take care of such patients. Coming to the diabetes mellitus and cognitive change, now this is a very important topic. And in the coming year, you know, we'll see a revolution in this topic. Diabetes affecting the memory, the cognition of the patient. Many studies have shown an association between diabetes, both type 1 and type 2, and the presence of cognitive decline. They are expected to have earlier dementia and earlier Alzheimer's, but there's no clear evidence. The exact cause of these cognitive changes remain unclear, and some studies have failed to reveal an association with HbA1c. In addition, it is thought that a state of hyperinsulinemia seen in type 2 diabetics may contribute to microvascular damage and may interfere with amyloid precursor protein metabolism, leading to cerebral beta amyloid deposits. So you see, age-related amyloid changes can be exacerbated and earlier in case of diabetics. And the microvascular damage is the one which is the reason, and the reason behind that is hyperglycemia and hyperinsulinemia. A very important topic, hyperglycemia, as a very important, you know, association with diabetes. Obviously, whenever you're treating, managing diabetes, hyperglycemia cannot be ignored. Symptoms of hyperglycemia may be broken down into two distinct constellations, that is autonomic manifestations and neuroglycopenic manifestations. And itself, they are associated with neuropsychiatric manifestations. So you have to be careful with the psychiatric manifestations. In such cases, check the blood glucose if patient is known high diabetic, especially. The autonomic effects are typically defined as adrenergic or catecholamine-mediated symptoms, including tachycardia, diaphoresis, tremor, weakness, hunger, irritability, and palpitations. All of these are, you know, manifestations of actually anxiety. These hyperandrogenic adrenergic symptoms can mimic a panic attack, actually. Patient can actually, you know, scream and shout and say to bring something to me to eat to combat this hyperglycemia. An inadequate supply of glucose to the central nervous system or neuroglycopenia may result in faintness, headache, blurred vision, lethargy, confusion, dizziness, weakness, incoordination, bizarre reversible focal neurological findings, seizures, and coma, which typically abates when with normalization of glucose levels. So they are more of the neurological manifestations, but can have some, you know, psychological and psychiatric manifestations associated with them. The differential diagnosis of fasting hypoglycemia must include surreptitious administration of either insulin or an oral hypoglycemic agent. Factitious hypoglycemia secondary to one of these agents must be considered prior to pancreatic exploration for an islet cell tumor in any patients with hyperinsulinism. So you see, whenever a patient is presenting with hypoglycemia, we are first of all seeing whether it is associated with diabetes or not. If it is a non-diabetic, then we have to start thinking if there is a hyperinsulinemia going on and if there is an insulin secreting tumor in the pancreas. So in such cases, make sure, because of the underlying psychiatric problem or associated psychiatric issue or some problem in the social or personal life of the patient, he or she can be erroneously or surreptitiously taking the insulin or oral hypoglycemic drug, which is being used by other family member or colleague at the workplace. And you have to rule that out before, you know, you start working upon islet cell tumor type of things. Presence of anti-insulin antibodies or low C-peptide levels at the time of hypoglycemia strongly suggests a factitious etiology. That means underlying insulin is normal. Insulin secretion is going on, which is normal. And this has been taken by the from the exogenous source. Screening of urine or blood for sulfonylurea is available for patients suspected of surreptitious oral hypoglycemic agent ingestion. And the sulfonylurea screen is going on, I think, in the Aga Khan lab as well. So you can order for that. An important issue in the psychopharmacological management of patients with hypoglycemia is the risk of, again, beta blocker therapy. Make sure the patient, check the drug list while the patient is taking, and maybe you find a beta blocker there, which after stopping, you can, you know, resolve the issue. So remember, early misdiagnosis of hypoglycemia as an anxiety disorder and treatment with agents whose action blocks the normal response to hypoglycemia may prevent the subjective experience of potentially lethal hypoglycemia. So this is a very important message. That's why I put it in this way in the slide, that misdiagnosis of hypoglycemia as an anxiety and then managing that hypoglycemia with the treatment, which can actually stop the manifestation of hypoglycemia itself, is again hazardous. So be very careful with the, take the proper blood history. This is something very important. Drug history, medical history, eating, diet, what's going on, what is the behavior, what is the diet pattern and timings. These are all, you know, very important factors to address the real problem. Now coming to the other important hormonal endocrine manifestation, endocrine disorders which are associated with psychiatric manifestations. Deviations in the gonadal hormones in male hypogonadism. Male hypogonadism of any etiology may cause significant psychological distress and impaired social adjustment. Low self-esteem and self-confidence and feelings of inadequacy, isolation, and alienation are common. Similarly, in females, the premenstrual dysphoric disorder. Diagnosis of this disorder requires 5 or more of the 11 possible symptoms which are present during the luteal phase. There are many, you know, premenstrual symptoms, and I think 11, counting them as 11 or so would be understatement. And still there are some important 5 symptoms which can be counted on, and they happen usually in approximately days 21 to 28 of the menstrual cycle, in the premenstrual phase. At least one of the 5 symptoms must be depressed mood, anxiety, affective lability, or irritability. And these happen in such cases. Derangements and dysregulation of the serotonergic system are the most probable causes of this PMDD. And treatment studies also support the serotonin hypothesis of PMDD causality, as SSRIs have proven efficacious in decreasing symptoms in such cases. So, I mean, premenstrual syndrome is usually, you know, happening in almost every female, but in some, there can be very severe and very, you know, disturbing. And in such cases, you often have to prescribe this SSRI to, you know, manage those days. Now, coming to the summary of the whole topic. I'll just briefly touch the topic individually, that the onset of symptoms of hypothyroidism is often gradual, and especially in the elderly, and mimics the development of a degenerative dementia. So always check TSH and rule out any metabolic cause or endocrine cause. In Cushing syndrome, depression is extremely common and persistent elation is rare. So Cushing would be more depressed. Diagnosis of Addison's disease commonly delayed. Risperidone is the atypical antipsychotic most likely to cause hyperprolactinemia. So in prolactin secreting adenoma, there is no psychiatric association because of hyperprolactinemia. Rather, it is the treatment which is leading to it. And acromegaly is associated with depression, psychosis, and amotivational syndrome. Those with insulin-dependent diabetes and eating disorders are frequently turned to insulin emission or underuse as a means to prevent weight gain and to promote weight loss. So be careful with them. Beta blocker therapy may prevent the normal sympathetic response to potentially lethal hypoglycemia in insulin-dependent diabetics especially. That is all, and thank you very much.